So welcome to tutorial 3 of unit 1, and in this particular tutorial lecture we will be talking about the Zener diode circuits. Now to start with, let me just tell you what is a Zener diode all about. So I have to start with the symbol of a Zener diode. Perhaps you know the symbol. So it looks something like that. It's basically a p-n junction diode with the cathode terminal looking like a Z. So this has been the symbol, and this is known to be the anode terminal, and this is known to be the cathode terminal. Now, as far as the VI characteristics of Zener diode is concerned, so let me just show you the VI characteristics. How does it look like? Basically, whenever I write V, this is basically the V anode to cathode voltage.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Which book do you have to follow?
Okay, I'll be telling this one after the end of this.
Okay, sir.
So let me just show you the VI characteristics of a Zener diode. So in fact, in the positive, so whenever the VAK value is greater than zero, when the diode is forward biased, so under this forward bias condition, the characteristics of Zener diode is just like a simple p-n junction diode. It will follow this exponential nature. And in the reverse bias region, what happens is you have initially, when the reverse voltage is less than a predetermined value, which is known as a Zener breakdown voltage, the current flowing through the Zener diode is very small. And when the reverse voltage is equal to or greater than the Zener voltage, Zener breakdown, then the current increases enormously, just like this. And this voltage is known as the Zener breakdown, that is VZ, that particular voltage. VZ, in fact, that value is negative. Now, what you find is for any Zener diode, if we consider ideal diode, ideal Zener diode, then that particular slope should be parallel to this current axis. So that means even if you change the voltage, the corresponding you'll find that the amount of Zener resistance is very small. So that's why eventually the terminal voltage between the anode to cathode remaining constant. Or in other words, I can say that even if the current flowing through the Zener diode increases enormously from this point to this point, the voltage across these two terminals remaining almost constant. But that is an ideal one whenever we are considering the Zener resistance to be equal to 0 ohms. But practically, the Zener resistance is not zero. Under the reverse bias condition, you can have a few tens of ohms over here. So this is unlike the reverse bias regions. In the reverse bias region, you find that over a certain range of the voltage, the current changes very little. That means within this region, within 0 to VZ, the value of the Zener resistance is very large. So that's why even if the current, even if the voltage changes, there is almost no change in the current. The current changes incrementally. But a different thing happens whenever the Zener breakdown is achieved. And here you find that with a small change between the terminal voltage, the corresponding change in the current can be very much. And that's why the Zener diode is popularly employed in the reverse bias region for the operation of the voltage regulation. That means even if you change the input voltage to some extent, you'll find that if you connect the Zener diode in the load side, then you'll find that the corresponding output voltage is remaining constant. Even if it is not constant, but the variation of the output voltage can be limited to some extent. Now, if I just once again observe that particular region, so what we find is it looks something like that in the reverse bias region, because we have nothing to worry in the forward bias region. So if I just once again, if I want to visualize that part, then it will be something like that. So let me consider this is my axis. And what happens is, unless this zener breakdown is achieved, the current is almost very small, ideally zero. And then you find that, although I have given a very high slope over here, not like this, it looks something like that. It's very small, and then it goes like this. So as you understand, this is the VAK part, and this is the current through the diode. Now this point from where this zener breakdown starts is known as the corresponding knee voltage or VZK. And suppose the maximum current that can be accommodated by the zener diode is given by IZM, the maximum current, because you cannot expect that any amount of current can be accommodated by the device. And if I consider that the maximum current over here, so if I just extend this particular axis to some extent, suppose this is the maximum current that can be accommodated. Although that particular graph is a little bit exaggerated. Anyway, let me assume that this is the maximum current that can be supported by the device, IZM. And then this voltage corresponding to this IZM is known as VZM. And this current corresponding to VZK is known as IZK. So therefore, the zener regulation operation starts whenever the zener current is just equal to or greater than IZK, and the zener regulation will be continued until and unless the zener current is limited to IZM. Therefore, the regulation occurs within this range, IZK less than equal to, I may call IZ less than equal to IZM. So this is the condition which has to be satisfied for regulation. That means here you find that even if the current changes enormously, IZK to IZM, the corresponding change in the voltage is very small. In fact, in this particular graph, I have zoomed in that part so that you can visualize this one. Otherwise, that variation is almost very negligibly small. And you can consider that this slope is almost parallel to the current axis. That means if I just calculate the resistance, so how to calculate the resistance? If I take the slope of that, it's IV characteristics. If I take the slope, so it is nothing but dy dx, that is di dv. So 1 upon slope will give you the corresponding resistance, 1 upon slope. And if you just calculate this 1 upon slope, that value is very small because the slope itself is very large. So therefore, the zener resistance is very small, in the range of a few tens of ohms. Ideally, it should be zero, but practically, you have few tens of ohms zener resistance. And that's why the corresponding value of a VZK and VZM, they are not equal. So how you can characterize this zener diode in the reverse bias or in the zener diode region, in the breakdown region? So that could have been accomplished like this. So the zener diode that I have shown over here, this is equivalent to, obviously in the breakdown region, this is equivalent to, between these 2 points, you have a resistance, which is known as a zener resistance. And apart from that, you have a battery like this. So if I consider, this is my cathode terminal, this is my anode terminal, then this resistance is, let me call ZZ, and this voltage, let me call VZ. So therefore, at any point of time, you can easily calculate the voltage across this anode to cathode. So how to find out this voltage? So this voltage is nothing but this VZ plus, if you just once again, if you just observe the polarity over here, you'll find that this polarity is something like this, plus minus here and plus minus when the current flows in this direction. So plus minus, so it will be added like this. So at any point of time, if I just find it out, what you can do is you can also put a zero mark over here to segregate it from VZ. So then the VZ value can be written as VZ naught plus the IZ multiplied with ZZ. Now, in fact, the variation of IZ will be there during the regulation, but the corresponding value of the Zener resistance is very small. So that's why the variation of VZ with respect to VZ0 or VZ0 is not that much. So I can have two different values for VZK from this expression itself. I can easily calculate. So if I put IZ is equal to IZK, then what I can write is VZK, that is the new voltage. So that voltage is equal to VZ0 plus IZK into ZZ and VZM. VZM is given by VZ0 VZ0 plus IZM into ZZ. So these values, IZK and IZM, the variation of these two values would have been very large, but because of the very low value of ZZ, the VZK and VZM, they are very much close to each other. And therefore, the Zener diode is popularly employed as a voltage regulator in many of the electronic circuits. Now, with this basic introduction of a Zener diode, now let me just once again recapitulate what we have done in the last class on the clipping circuit. Now, what we have done is we have used a simple p-n junction diode. A simple p-n junction diode, we have connected them in the series path, we have connected in the, across the output terminals as well, and accordingly, we have got different types of waveforms. So now let's do the same thing with the Zener diode into operation. So what I mean to say is that I have, say, let's make things simple. I have a resistance over here, and let's connect two Zener diode. Let's connect two Zener diode in this fashion. There is one Zener diode like this, and back to back second Zener diode like this. Okay, so let's call this to be say 1k, 1 kilo ohms resistance, and we are this terminal is obviously the ground terminal. We are measuring voltage with respect to this one, and this is my output terminal V out, and this is the input terminal with respect to the ground. And let's call the input signal is just like a sinusoidal signal with its peak at 10 volt. And the negative peak at minus 10 volt, just like this. And we have to mention the Zener breakdown voltage corresponding to these two Zener diodes. Let's call that these two Zener diodes are not identical, and this one is having a Zener breakdown voltage of 3.3 volt. So this one is having a Zener breakdown voltage of 3.3 volt, and this one is having a Zener breakdown voltage of 5.1 volt. Now, under this condition, if I apply a simple sinusoidal signal like this. Now let us try to understand what happens at the output side. So first of all, let me draw the one full cycle of the input waveform. One full cycle of the input waveform like this. So this one is plus 10, this one is minus 10. Now here you find that these two Zener diodes are connected in such a way that whenever one diode is in forward bias condition, the other diode will be in the reverse bias condition. So first of all, you have to analyze the basic principle of operation of these type of circuits. So since they are connected in that way that the cathodes of these two diodes are connected together, so therefore, when one diode is in forward bias condition, the other diode will be in the reverse bias condition. So in fact, you can visualize that there are two switches. There are two switches which are connected in series path. like this, you have a resistance over here. This is the ground terminal, and you're measuring the output with respect to this one. So basically, the circuit gets simplified like this, Vin. So basically, you have two switches because we have two diodes. Now, what we have discussed in the last class, the same analogy is also applicable over here, that whenever because these two switches are connected in the series path. So in order to ensure that a current flows through the circuit, so both of these two switches should be closed. If any of the switches is open, then obviously the current doesn't flow. That means there is no current, so input voltage is equal to the output voltage. Since there is no current, so the input voltage will be equal to the output voltage. That is fine. That could have been fine for a simple diode. But since you have a Zener diode, so you have to consider that whenever one of the diodes, suppose let's consider one diode is in the forward bias condition, fine. Now, if the second diode, as long as the second diode is in the reverse bias condition, so obviously one switch is closed and one switch is open, so there will be no current flow. But if when one diode is forward bias and the other diode has entered into the breakdown region, in which case you will find that there is enormous amount of current flowing through the circuit, that means both of these two switches will be on. And accordingly, you have to find out what about the voltage that you are getting across these two diodes. So let's start from the positive half cycle. What happens in the positive half cycle? Here you find in the positive half cycle, this input voltage will be positive, and the anode, let me give two different names for the diodes. So diode, this one is D1, this one is D2. So in the positive half cycle, as you find, diode D1 will be in the forward bias condition because the anode is connected to the input terminal through a resistance, and in the positive half cycle, this input is always positive. So, let's consider there is a 0.7 volt drop. Forget about that. Apart from that, if I just consider the most of the period in the positive half cycle, diode D1 will be forward bias because the anode is connected to the input side and the input is positive during the positive half cycle. That is fine. Now, what happens with the diode D2? Now, as you find here, this anode terminal is connected to the ground potential. So as long as this anode is connected to the ground potential, so D2 will be in the reverse bias condition in the positive half cycle, because anode is connected to the ground and the cathode is also having some positive voltage. So obviously D2 will be in the reverse bias condition. Now, if the diode D2 is a simple p-n junction diode, then obviously there will be no current flow. And you can understand that the input will be, the output and the input will be the same in the positive half cycle. But it doesn't happen here because one of the diodes, in fact, both of the diodes are Zener diodes. Now, since they are Zener diodes, so in the positive half cycle, D1 will be forward biased, but as long as this voltage difference, the anode to cathode voltage difference, as long as this voltage is less than 5.1 volt, this diode D2 will be in the reverse bias region. So let me once again come back to the previous slide, and let me tell you there are three different regions for operation. One is the forward bias region, when this one is greater than 0 or 0.7 volt, cut-in voltage. So this is the forward bias operation. Then the second region, when the diode is in the reverse bias condition, that means when the input voltage is negative, but less than VZ. And the second and the third operation, the third region is known as the breakdown region, where this anode to cathode voltage, where this value is greater than VZ. And here you have to understand that this voltage is a negative voltage. So you are basically applying a negative voltage between the anode to cathode. So this diode D2 will receive some negative voltage in the positive half cycle because anode is connected. So the anode to cathode voltage means we are measuring the voltage like this, assuming this to be positive, this to be negative. So we are measuring this voltage. Now, if this voltage is less than minus of 5.1, like minus 5.5, minus 5.7, minus 5.9, when this reverse bias voltage is less than this breakdown voltage, then the diode D2 will enter into the reverse bias, will enter into the breakdown region, from the reverse bias region, and then you will find a current flow will be there. And obviously, in the positive half cycle, D1 will be conducting. And when the D1 is conducting in the positive half cycle, then you find when the D1 is conducting, and then obviously there is a 0.7 volt drop between anode to cathode terminal. So since we are measuring with respect to this one, with respect to the cathode to anode, because we have to ensure that this cathode to anode voltage, VAK, should be positive. Let me just show you once again. When D1 is conducting, in the positive half cycle, you have a 0.7 volt drop over here. And in order to ensure D2 to enter into the breakdown region, let me write it down. D2 will enter into the breakdown region when the condition is the anode to cathode voltage should be less than minus 5.1, because basically that voltage is a negative voltage. Or in other words, what you can say is the cathode to anode voltage should be greater than plus 5.1. So the same thing, the anode to cathode voltage VAK should be less than minus 5.1, or in other words, or it's equivalent to the cathode to anode voltage is greater than 5.1. So now when the input voltage, as so obviously there is a, so whenever you are measuring like cathode to anode voltage, so obviously under this condition, so we are measuring with respect to the anode terminal. So then our reference is different. So then it will be plus minus like this. So you have to ensure that that voltage, that drop should be at least 5.1. That drop should be at least 5.1, so that the diode D2 enters into the breakdown region. And obviously that drop should be equal to 0.7 volt, so that the diode D1 conducts. Now if I add, because plus minus, now if you add these two together, so the input voltage should be at least equal to 5.8 volt. 5.1 here plus 0.7 here, at least it should be 5.8 volt, so that the diode D1 is forward biased and diode D2 has entered into the breakdown region. Then only a current will be flowing through the circuit, and you find, assuming obviously that these two diodes are, they don't have any Zener resistance or a forward bias resistance equal to zero, assuming that ZZ value of this diode is equal to zero, D2 is equal to zero, and the dynamic resistance of the diode D1 in the forward bias region is also zero. With this condition, then that voltage should be equal to 5.8 volt, and the output will be remaining constant at 5.8 volt. Now, what happens beyond 5.8 volt? Beyond 5.8 volt, you find that diode D1 will be conducting, obviously, because it is in the forward bias, but D2 will not be conducting. It will enter into the breakdown. It will enter into the reverse bias region from the breakdown region. So therefore, there is no flow of the current. And if there is no flow of the current, then the input and output will be the same. So accordingly, if the input voltage is greater than 5.8 volt, greater than or equal to 5.8 volt, then you find that the output gets constant at 5.8. And if it is less than this, then the output will follow the input. So this voltage, so that voltage is equal to, sorry, it should be, yeah, 5.8 volt, 5.1 plus 0.7. So 5.8 volt, this voltage. And this one, this peak is at 10 volt. That is corresponding to the input signal. Now what happens in the reverse bias region? The reverse bias region, the different scenario will happen. Now what happens is in the reverse bias region, the D2, the diode D2 will be conducting, because here this potential, this input signal will be negative, and the cathode terminal is negative, anode terminal is having a potential of zero. So D2 will be conducting, but D1 initially, the D1 will be in the reverse bias region, but D2 will be conducting. Now, since you have two different switches, they are in the series path, and if until and unless both of them are conducting, there will be no flow of current. So therefore, initially, whenever the input goes zero, beyond zero, from this point goes negative, initially, there is no flow of the current, and accordingly, the input and the output will be the same. And once again, the diode D1 will enter into the breakdown region whenever the cathode to anode voltage for the diode D1 is greater than 3.3 volt, or anode to cathode voltage is less than minus 3.3 volt. So once again, these voltage, so as long as the input voltage is less than, if I just consider here 3.3 volt, and here it will be having another 0.7 volt, so total is 4 volt. So in the negative direction, as long as the input voltage is greater than minus 4 volt, as long as it is greater than minus 4 volt, you will find that there is no flow of the current, because diode D1 has not entered into the breakdown region. It is still there in the reverse bias region. So there is no flow of the current. Now, when the input voltage goes below minus 4 volt, because minus 4 volt is the minimum voltage, under this condition, you have a 3.3 volt across these two terminals and 0.7 volt across these two terminals. So beyond this point, beyond minus 4 volt, the output gets constant at minus 4. So I think it will be even less. If it is 4 or minus 4, oh, sorry. So let me just mark 4 like this. So let's assume that this is minus 4. So this one is minus 4 volt. So this will be the nature of the output. So this is the V out. Now, with this basic understanding of a simple Zener diode circuit, now let us move to a practical circuit where the Zener diode is used as a regulator. Now, let me just show you how does the circuit look like. In fact, the circuit is simple like this. The Zener diode is connected across a load.
Sir, after the breakdown region, the Zener diode will be replaced by a single wire, a conducting wire, or infinite resistance. Means voltage will be regulated, but what will be the replacement of the Zener diode after the breakdown?
After the breakdown means what? What do you mean by after the breakdown? During the breakdown or? During the breakdown, the Zener diode, during the breakdown, the Zener diode will be replaced by a wire during the breakdown, because it can withstand any amount of current, assuming that the current is less than the IZM that I mentioned. Because if you allow the current is greater than IZM, then obviously the device will be damaged. But that you have to ensure that the current is limited, is less than IZM. So as long as the current is in between IZK to IZM, so that means this Zener diode can be represented by means of a simple, like you have a simple VZ not like this. So you can also consider ZZ. That's a practical case that apart from this battery, you should be having one another resistance, but that value is very small. That is the scenario in the breakdown region. And in the forward bias region, you can consider, okay, that is simply that value is equal to 0.7 volt with some associated resistance that you can neglect sometimes. And in the reverse bias region, the Zener diode is simply represented by means of an open circuit. Okay, so let me just take up this problem, then you can understand what is the implication of this the maximum Zener current, and what is the implication of the minimum Zener current, and how the regulation is possible. What happens is, okay, let me just consider in that way. Let me just forget about this Zener diode initially, and let's consider that, okay, I'm having a situation like this. Let me just formulate the problem. say you have a resistance over here, a variable resistance over here, RL. And let's a fixed resistance over here. Let me call that resistance to be say 22 ohms. And suppose we are applying some input voltage. Let me call that input as a constant one. I mean a DC voltage over here. And you are measuring the output voltage with respect to this ground potential. So this is the output voltage you are measuring with respect to this ground potential, V out. So as you can see here, the output voltage can be simply written by means of a simple voltage divider law. V out is equal to V in upon RL plus this 22 ohms multiplied with this RL. And that's why this V out is a strong function of RL. So as you change this load resistance, so accordingly, you'll find that this output voltage gets affected. So sometimes you need that my output voltage should be remaining constant in spite of the corresponding change in the input side. So even if there is certain change in the input voltage, the output voltage should be constant in ideal sense, or in practical sense, you can say that even if the input voltage changes by a large amount, the corresponding change in the output voltage should be restricted. And that is known as the line regulation. So I'm coming to that, the definition of line regulation, what is the meaning of the line regulation? The thing is that here you can simply find it out, V out as a function of V in, RL, and the series resistance. And V out is a strong function of the V in and RL. Now, in order to ensure that even if my input voltage changes over a large margin, I want that my output voltage should be remaining constant. So let me just, let me first of all write down the expression for the output voltage, which is quite obvious. This expression for the output voltage is given by V in upon, let me call that resistance to be say R, say RL plus R into RL. Now let's assume that there are two parameters, two variables which are varying. Two parameters which are varying. One is, say, let me assume that R is constant, that resistance 22 ohms is constant, but RL is varying. As you can see over here, RL is varying. So therefore, I can write V out as a function of V in and RL. So the output voltage may be changing and will be changing if either of these two parameters gets modified. If the input voltage changes, then there is a possibility that the output voltage will be modified. And if the resistance RL changes by some amount, there also you can find that the corresponding change will take place. And that variation is even more significant when the value of RL is significant. So now in order to get rid of that, what we can do is we can put a Zener diode across the output terminal, which can regulate the corresponding variation in the output voltage, even if the input voltage changes by a large amount, or even if the load resistance changes. Because as you can understand, if the load resistance changes, the RL value, if the value of RL changes, then obviously it will be having the corresponding effect on the value of the output voltage. So what we can do is we can connect one Zener diode, and obviously since the input voltage is a DC one, let's consider the input DC voltage. So the Zener diode should be connected in such a way that it is under a breakdown region. That means the anode to cathode voltage should be negative. So how should I connect this one? So I should connect the Zener diode like this way. Now, if the input potential is just the opposite, if the polarity is reversed, like this point positive and this point negative, then I have to connect the Zener diode in the opposite way, opposite direction, just by changing the position of the anode and cathode terminal, just by swapping the position of the anode and cathode, so that the Zener diode always operates in the reverse bias region. That means the anode to cathode voltage should be negative. Now, there are certain specifications. So let me just come to the specifications. So the specification says that the value of VZ for the Zener diode, VZ is equal to 5.1 volt when the IZ value is equal to 49 milliampere. That is the one specification. The second specification says that the IZK, the knee current, the knee zener current should be equal to, is equal to 1 milliampere. IZM, that is the maximum zener current, is equal to say 70 milliampere. And the ZZ value, that means the zener resistance, is given by 7 ohms. Now you need to find out the maximum and the minimum permissible load currents. So what could have been the maximum and minimum possible load currents so that the Zener diode continue the operation of regulation? So as long as the Zener diode, so let me once again go back to the previous slide, in fact the first slide. So you have to ensure that the output voltage is remaining constant, almost constant. It will not be exactly constant because in this particular problem you have a Zener resistance that is equal to 7 ohms. Now, because of the Zener resistance, as you find here, you have some VZ naught, and apart from that, you have some ZZ. So because of the drop across this ZZ, the potential difference between this anode to cathode, these two terminals, will never be constant. But since the value of ZZ is very small, so that can be regulated to some extent. But you have to remember that simplification or that specification of the Zener diode by means of this resistance and battery is only possible if and only if the Zener diode operates within that particular region. That means whenever the current through the Zener diode is greater than or equal to IZK and less than or equal to IZM. So this is the knee Zener current and this is the maximum Zener current. So you have to always ensure that in order to regulate the output voltage, the current flowing through the Zener diode should be greater than the knee current and should be less than the maximum current. Because if it is less than the knee current, then obviously the Zener diode enters into the breakdown, into the reverse bias region from the breakdown region. And if it is greater than IZM, if it is greater than the maximum Zener diode, maximum Zener current, then obviously the diode gets damaged. So that is a specification as provided by the manufacturer. So that you have to keep in mind always. Now here in this problem, it is told that the minimum current should be, the minimum current flowing through the circuit should be 1 milliampere and the maximum current flowing through the circuit should be 70 milliampere with a Zener resistance is equal to 7 ohms. Now the condition is that another thing has been specified, that when the Zener current is equal to 49 milliampere, that means in between these two value, 1 milliampere and 70 milliampere, then the VZ value is equal to 5.1. So first of all, you have to identify the two extreme voltages across the anode to cathode terminals of the Zener diode. What are those two extreme voltages? First of all, you have to consider when the current flowing through the Zener diode is equal to 1 milliampere, that is IZK, then what about the voltage difference between these two terminals? So what I mean to say is that the Zener diode in the breakdown region can be approximated, as you have already seen, and that can be approximated like this. You have a resistance and you have a DC power supply like this. So this one is ZZ and this one is VZ naught. So what about this VZ? If I call this difference, if I call this difference, let me call this difference to be say VZ, with this terminal positive with respect to this terminal, then this VZ is given by VZ naught plus IZ into ZZ for any arbitrary IZ flowing to the device. Now this VZ naught has not been provided here. What has been given? The value of VZ at any particular IZ. Now that can be easily calculated because you have a simple resistive devices over here, simple resistance over here. So I can write it down like this. the same equation, Vz is equal to Vz naught plus Iz into Zz. And it is also true Vzk is equal to Vz naught plus Izk into Zz. So these are the two equations to start with. This is for any arbitrary current within that range, Zk to Zm. And this one is for the knee current. Now, if I just subtract one from two, what I find is Vz minus Vzk, that is equal to Iz minus Izk into Zz. So Vz is equal to Vzk plus Iz minus Izk into Zz. Now, what has been provided here, you'll find that the value of Vzk has not been given over here. The value of Vz has been provided. And that value is equal to 5.1 volt. And similarly, we can write down another equation corresponding to the maximum Zener current. And that expression gives you Vzm is equal to Vz naught plus Izm into Zz. That could have been considered as a third equation. So if I just once again observe this anode to cathode terminal of a Zener diode operating. So we are talking about this voltage. And in fact, in our case, this is basically the output voltage. If you just look at this particular diagram, this voltage is nothing but the output voltage, that is V out. So that voltage we can write like V out or output voltage. So whenever the more amount of current is flowing through the circuit, so accordingly, you can find out the value of Vz based upon the difference in the current. Initially, you have some Vz naught that is fixed, and plus you have the variation in the current. So initially, it has been told that the Iz value is equal to 49 milliampere and Izk is equal to 1 milliampere. So based on that, you can find out what is the value of V out. So that V out can be written as, so that expression of V out can be written as, that is nothing but Vz. Okay, I can do another thing. What I can do is I can just put the V out of. So what I find is Vzm is equal to Vz naught plus Izm Zz. Okay, so that expression is coming from 1 minus 2. Give me this one. And another thing. One minus three. That gives me Vz minus Vzm is equal to iz minus izm into zz. So this is another way to write down the expression for vzm. So I can write vzm like this. So vzm is equal to vz minus iz minus izm into zz. Or in other words, that can be written like vz plus izm minus iz into zz. Now this izm minus iz, that is the corresponding variation in the Zener current. So that can be written like, say, delta iz, vz plus delta iz into zz. So now already you know what is value of delta iz, because iz has been given as 49 milliampere and izm is given like 70 milliampere and zz is given like 7 ohms and vz is also provided like 5.1 volt. So the test current is 49 milliampere. Let me write it down once again. The test current iz is equal to 49 milliampere, that is known as the test current. Any current in between the knee current and the Zener maximum current, which is known as the test current, iz is equal to 49, vz is equal to 5.1, test voltage 5.1 volt, and you have izm like 70 milliampere. So what about the Vout then under this condition? So this Vout can be written like, you have 5.1, let me once again consider the previous expression, plus izm minus iz into zz. So 5.1 you have plus izm minus iz will give you 21, 70 milliampere minus 49 milliampere. So I think it will be better if I write it down like 70 minus 49. Then you can understand from where it is coming. 70 minus 49 milliampere means 10 to the power minus 3 into, you have a zz of 7 ohms. So let me do the calculation. It says that the second expression will give 21 into 0.007, that means 0.147. so 5.1 plus 0.147, that will be equal to 5.247 volt. Now that is the voltage when the maximum current is flowing through the circuit, flowing through the Zener diode. Similarly, so 5.247 volt when iz, Zener current, is equal to, or I should not write iz is equal to izm, because that can create some confusion. Could write literally when izm is flowing, and that is the maximum limit. You cannot have any current higher than izm flowing through the circuit or flowing through the Zener diode. Similarly, you can also calculate on the, what about the value of the Vout when the Zener knee current is flowing. The expression will be same. So Vout will be equal to 5.1 So let me just refer back to that expression once again. So here you find, already we have written that expression. So here you find Vz is equal to Vzk plus Iz minus Izk into Zz. So what about Vzk? So Vzk is nothing but Vz minus of Iz minus Izk into Zz. So if you just follow the same principle, then it will be 5.1 minus of, here you find 49 minus 1. Into 10 to the power minus 3 into 7. So this will give you 48 into 0.007, that means 0.56. So 5.1 minus 0.336. And if you calculate 5.1 minus 0.56, will give you 4.764. 4.764 volt. So this is the voltage when IZK is flowing. So these are the two extreme conditions. When IZK is flowing through the circuit, that means the minimum current is flowing through the circuit, and then that voltage equal to 4.764 volt, that voltage with respect to ground, that potential should be equal to 4.764 volt. And when the maximum zener current is flowing through the circuit, then that voltage is given by 5.247, irrespective of the value of the input voltage. But remember here, it has been specified, suppose that the input voltage is given by, say, 8 volt. Suppose the input voltage is given by 8 volt. Input voltage is equal to 8 volt. So irrespective of the value of this load resistance, what you find is that voltage potential at this point is equal to 4.764 volt when the minimum current is flowing through the zener diode, and that voltage is equal to 5.247 volt when the maximum current is flowing through the zener diode. Then what is the purpose of having this load resistance over here? The purpose is, depending upon the amount of the excess current, the load resistance will be able to carry that amount of current. And from that, you can find the answer to the question. The question was the minimum and the maximum permissible load currents. What about the minimum and the maximum permissible load currents? That means what about the maximum current flowing through the circuit, flowing through the load. This is the load current IL. So what could have been the value of IL min and IL max? So to answer this question, let me consider a situation when the IZ value is equal to IZK. And here you find this potential is equal to 4.764 volt. This potential here at 8 volt, and this potential here is 4.764 volt when the zener current is equal to zener knee current. So now if I divide the total current into two different parts, so this is the total current I, and it is having two different components. One is the current through the zener diode, and second one is the current through the load. So what I can write is this I of I is equal to IZ plus IL. That means the zener current plus the current through the load resistance from the simple KCL law. So what about the value of I when IZ is equal to IZK? So when IZ is equal to, let me refer this circuit once again. So when I is equal to, current through the zener diode is equal to IZK, then this potential is equal to 4.764 volt. This potential is equal to 8 volt. So you can simply find out what is the current flowing through the circuit. So that current, so I is equal to 8 volt minus 4.764 volt divided by 22. So 8 minus 4.764 divided 22 will give you around 147 milliampere. So 147 milliampere. So this is the current when IZK, that means when the zener current is zener knee current. So as you find, 147 milliampere current is flowing through this path. 147 milliampere current is flowing through this 22 ohms resistance. And the zener diode can accept only 1 milliampere current through it. So rest 146 milliampere current will be obviously flowing through the load resistance. And remember, as the load resistance value is modified here, because here you don't have any option to change the input voltage. It has been mentioned that the input voltage is constant at 8 volt. So if the input voltage is constant at 8 volt, how can you change the current through the zener diode? That can only be done by changing the load resistance value. Now, if the load resistance value is modified, then the current through the zener diode can be regulated accordingly. But in no case, you can expect any current less than knee current and higher than the maximum zener current to ensure the process of regulation. So 147 milliampere is the amount of current, and that should be the maximum current which can be, because during this time, the zener diode can accommodate only the minimum current. So that difference here, as you find here, the difference is only 8 volt minus 4.764 volt. And when the zener diode is conducting, the maximum current is passing, the maximum current of IZM, that is 70 milliampere in this case, then that potential is equal to 5.247 volt. Now, if this potential is 5.247 volt, then obviously, since the voltage difference is small, because that voltage is constant at 8 volt, and that voltage is 5.247 volt, and this resistance is constant, 22 ohms. So obviously, when the zener diode is carrying the maximum current, that is IZM, then obviously, the total current is also small, because this potential is at 5.247, this potential is at 8. So with respect to this 4.764 volt, that current will be small. And out of the small current, the zener diode is carrying most of the current. So the rest of the current will be flowing through the load resistance. And that is the minimum zener, minimum load current flowing through the circuit. So what about the maximum load current? So maximum load current will occur when the zener diode is carrying the minimum current. That means when the zener diode is carrying only 1 milliampere amount of current, then this potential is having a value of 4.764 volt. So since the potential difference is maximum, so maximum current will be flowing through the circuit, and the load resistance will carry the excess amount of current. So from that, you can find out the maximum load current. So IL max. So IL max is given by 147 milliampere is the total current, and out of that, 1 milliampere current is scattered by the zener diode. So rest of the current, that is 146 milliampere amount of current, will be carried by the load resistance, that is RL. So that is the calculation with IZ is equal to IZK. Now let us take up the situation when the current flowing through the circuit, or current flowing through the resistance R, is minimum. That will happen when this potential is having a value of 5.247 volt, or in other words, when the zener diode is carrying the maximum current. Then what about this current? Then you can easily calculate this current, current flowing through the resistance, 22 ohms. That current is nothing but 8 volt minus you have 5.247 volt divided by 22 ohms. So let me calculate the value, 5.247 divided by 22 will give you around 125 milliampere amount of current. So now you look at the difference. When the zener diode is carrying the minimum current, then the total current supplied by the circuit is 147. When the zener diode is carrying the minimum current, then the total current supplied by the circuit is 147 milliampere. And when the zener diode is carrying the maximum current, then the total current supplied by the circuit is only 125 milliampere. And out of this 125 milliampere amount of current, 70 milliampere of current will be passing through the zener diode. So 125 milliampere is the total current, and out of that, so that is the situation when IZM is flowing through the circuit. So total current is 125. Out of that, IZM current is taken away by the zener diode. So if I just, okay, let me mention what is IZM value. The IZM is equal to, it was like 70 milliampere. Then what about the load current? So this load current will be the minimum load current. So that is nothing but 125 minus 70 milliampere. That is 55 milliampere. So the question to what we have got, two different questions like minimum and the maximum permissible load current. So we have already got the answer to these questions. One was the minimum load current. The minimum load current is 55 milliampere, and the maximum load current is equal to 146 milliampere. And accordingly, you can also find out what is the value of the minimum value of the load resistance and the maximum value of the load resistance. So this IL min, IL max, the maximum load current happens with Zener current is equal to the Zener knee current. And as you find, IL min happens with IZ is equal to IZM. Now, when IZ is equal to IZK, you can calculate what is the value of V out. Already we have seen that value of V out is equal to 4.764 volt. 4.764 volt. And when IZ is equal to IZM, I have got the value of V out to be 5.247 volt. So now this output voltage is also coming across the load, I mean across this this resistance, load resistance. So if you know this output voltage and if you know the load current, you can very easily calculate the load resistance RL. When IL is IL minimum, then the RL should be maximum. And if when IL is equal to IL maximum, then RL should be the minimum one. So accordingly, you can calculate the RL minimum and RL maximum. So RL minimum, the minimum value of the load resistance is can be computed like you have like 4.764 volt upon what about the current? That current was 146 milliampere amount of current. The maximum current was flowing through the load, so the load resistance should be the minimum one. And if you just calculate the value, it is coming like, yeah, it's like 32.6 kilo ohms. It's coming like 32.6 kilo ohms. And similarly, you can also calculate the value of RL max, and that RL max is coming like 5.247 volt divided by the current was 55 milliampere, because now the load resistance will carry minimum amount of current, so that's why the corresponding value of the load resistance is maximum. If you put the value here, you will find that it is coming like 95.4 kilo ohms. So these are the two extreme values for the load resistance, RL minimum and RL maximum. So the load resistance cannot be less than 32.6. So although in this particular diagram, it has been shown that RL is varying, but you have to remember that although it is varying like this, but you have to ensure that 32.6K should be less than or equal to RL, should be less than or equal to 95.4K. So that condition has to be satisfied. Otherwise, the regulation is not possible. What problem you can expect if the value of RL is less than 32.6K? So the value of RL should be greater than 32.6K. Now, if the value of RL is less than 32.6K, then what happens is you are reducing the load resistance value. Now, if you reduce the value beyond 32.6, then obviously this load resistance will carry more amount of current because you're reducing the load resistance. Now the total current supplied by the circuit was 147 milliampere, and already the load resistance with this value of with 32.6 kilo ohms, it is carrying like 146 milliampere amount of current. Now if you further reduce the value of load resistance beyond this point, then what happens? The current flowing through the Zener diode will be less than the Zener knee current. And if the IZ value is less than the Zener knee current, then the Zener diode will lose its regulation. So if you make the value of RL less than RL minimum, then the Zener diode will lose its regulation. That is the first condition. And on the other hand, if you use any value of the load resistance higher than 95.4 kilo ohms, then what happens? Now, if the load resistance value is greater than 95.4 kilo-ohm, that means you are increasing the value of load resistance beyond this point. What happens? The load resistance now, it will carry less amount of current. Now, what you have seen is the total current supplied by the circuit was 125 milliampere. And out of that, 55 milliampere amount of current was carried by the load resistance. And that was the minimum load current. Now, if you further increase the value of the load resistance beyond 95.4, then obviously the current flowing through the load resistance will be even less. It will be less than 55 milliampere amount of current. Now, the total current supplied was 125. Now, if the current flowing through the load resistance is less than 55, simple arithmetic says that the current flowing through the Zener diode should be greater than 70 milliampere current. But the thing is that you cannot accommodate, the Zener diode cannot accommodate any amount of current higher than IZM. If you make any attempt to allow more amount of current beyond the maximum limit, then the Zener diode will get damaged. And accordingly, what happens? The entire regulation process will be stopped. So that's why this is the permissible limit for the load resistance. The minimum value should be 32.6 and the maximum value should be 95.4. Within that range only, you can expect that the load resistance and the Zener diode combination will be able to provide the corresponding. So here you find that there is a large fluctuation. There is a large fluctuation of the load resistance value from 32.6 to 95.4 kilo-ohms. But still, what you find is the corresponding fluctuation in the output voltage is not that much. So in order to understand this one, or in order to quantify this one, that regulation, what is known as, that is known as a load regulation. So formally, this load regulation, so hopefully that was also there in the lecture video. Still I'm mentioning in regard to this particular problem. See, load regulation is given as, so let me just write down the expression first and then I'll be explaining what is meant by VNL and what is meant by VFL. So this is basically the no load voltage minus the full load voltage divided by full load voltage into 100%. That is known as the load regulation. And you should always expect that that load regulation should be as small as possible. That means ideally this no load voltage and full load voltage should be the same, but it never happens. First of all, you have to understand what is meant by the no load voltage and what is meant by the full load voltage. So whenever we say no load voltage, that means it's VNL. It's a no load. That means no load current. Whenever we say no load, that means no load current or minimum load current. Or I should write, so no load means no load, no or minimum. No or minimum load current. Now, when the load current flowing through the load is minimum or no, that means zero, then what is the voltage that you are getting? That is known as the no load voltage. And similarly, you have VFL, which is known as the full load. So here also, when the full or maximum load current, so it is defined with respect to the load current. So in our case, what you have found is this percentage load regulation, percentage load regulation, how much? You have seen that the variation is not that much. The variation is from, so when, let me go back to this previous slide. When the load current was minimum, IL minimum, when IL is equal to IL minimum, that means the minimum load current or no load current, what about the corresponding output voltage? It is coming like 5.247 volt. And what about the full load voltage? So full load voltage happens when the load current is maximum or full, that is 4.764 volts. So you can easily put the value of the load regulation like 5.247 minus 4.764 divided by 4.764 multiplied with 100%. So here you find, if you just do the calculation, what I find is 5.247 minus 4.764 divided 4.764 into 100%, it is coming like almost 10%. It's coming like only 10%. So 10% is the variation, that is known as the load regulation. There is another concept which is known as the line regulation. So line regulation happens when the input voltage changes over a certain range. When the input voltage changes, then what about the corresponding change in the output voltage? That is known as the line regulation. And let's take up one problem in regard to the line regulation. Line regulation, I think it will be better to write down the expression for the line regulation. So line regulation is defined like this. Line regulation is defined like the corresponding change in the output voltage with respect to the input voltage. So delta V out upon delta V in multiplied with 100%. So in the previous example, what we have considered, the input voltage was constant, that is 8 volt DC, but the corresponding load resistance was varying and accordingly the load current was varying. So that's why the concept of load regulation was there. And whenever you find that there is some change in input voltage, and if you have some Zener diode present in the output side, then the corresponding variation of the input voltage will not be reflected that much in the output side. And then you can regulate the corresponding variation in the output voltage, and the line regulation can be obtained accordingly. Now let's take another problem pertaining to this line regulation. Now here, let's have a similar kind of circuit like this. Here was Zener diode connected in the reverse biased 3-1 plus operation with the resistance equal to 5.
The last slide one.
Last slide, yeah.
Okay, sir.
Okay, that is all about the regulation, load regulation and the line regulation. So the output voltage you are taking with respect to this term, you know, this one is output voltage and this one is input voltage. Okay. Here problem is you have to find out the minimum input voltage which is required for the regulation. So nothing has been specified about the minimum input voltage. So last time you have seen that the voltage was given like 8 volt, but this time no voltage has been specified. So you need to find out the minimum input voltage that is required for the regulation. And what has been mentioned is the Zener knee current, IZK. Is IZK is given like 1.5 milliampere. And VZ is given like 14 volt. And initially, you can assume that ZZ, that is the Zener resistance, is equal to 0 ohms initially. That means the Zener diode can be equivalently represented by means of a simple battery, nothing more than that. So you need to find out the minimum input voltage required for the regulation. Because as you can observe over here, so the current that will be flowing. So over here, you don't have any additional load resistance connected in parallel with this Zener diode. So what about the current flowing through this path? So that kind will be flowing through the Zener diode. So the circuit is pretty simple. So if that current is I, so that I will be flowing through the Zener diode. So now it's very easy to find out the Zener current. So that current is nothing but this V in minus V out divided by this 560 ohms. So the current I, that is equal to IZ, because you don't have any additional load resistance path through which the current can be divided. So that is given by V in minus V out divided by this 560 ohms. That's fine. Now, you have to find out the minimum input voltage that is required for the regulation. Now, this V out, that means the potential over here, since ZZ is equal to 0 ohms, so what you can do is, once again, I can draw the equivalence. We have a circuit like this. Now, here if ZZ is equal to 0 ohms, then that is nothing but a simple battery, nothing more than that, plus minus VZ. If you have a ZZ, then obviously it should be there in series with this VZ. But since the ZZ is equal to 0 ohms, so this Zener diode can be always regarded like a battery of magnitude VZ. So therefore, this IZ value will be minimum when Vin is minimum, because everything is constant. V out is fixed, that is 14 volt, and this is also fixed, 560 ohms. So when Vin is minimum, then IZ should be minimum. So the question is, you have to find out the minimum input voltage required for the regulation. So accordingly, the minimum input voltage V in minimum occurs when the current through the circuit is also minimum, that is IZ is equal to IZK. And that current has been specified like 1.5 milliampere. So what you can write is V in minus 14 volt divided by 560 ohms. That is equal to the IZK, that is 1.5 milliampere. So from that, you can easily deduce the value of V in. So the value of V in, if you just calculate, let me do the calculation for you, it's like 560 ohms into 1.5 milliampere, that means 0.84. It's coming like 0.84, so 14.84. 14.84 volt. So that is the V in value, 14.84 volt. So nothing has been specified about the maximum Zener current. The minimum Zener current is specified like 1.5 milliampere. That is fine. And accordingly, you can find out the minimum input voltage that is required for the regulation. Now, if I add the maximum Zener current, let's assume that although it has not been specified in the problem itself. Now, let's assume that IZM is equal to 70 milliampere, like before. In the previous problem also, you have seen that IZK was 1 milliampere and IZM was 70 milliampere. Now, let's take upon that particular data from the previous problem. Now, when IZM is equal to 70 milliampere, then what about the input voltage? So the same formula will be there. So then you find V in minus 14 volt divided by 560 is equal to 70 milliampere, 17 10 to the power minus 3. And from that, you can calculate V in to be, so it is like 70 milliampere into 560 ohms divided, I would say 39.2. Let me check once again, 560 ohms into 70 milliampere into 0.001, 39.2. So it's coming like 39.2 plus 14, that means 53.2 volt. 53.2 volt. It's coming like 53.2 volt. So what you find is, if the input voltage changes over a range from 14.85 volt to 53.2 volt, that's a large range, 14 point something to 53 point something, almost a variation of 40 volt or so. So there is no change in the output voltage. So output voltage is remaining constant. That is only possible because the ZZ value is equal to 0. So that's why the output voltage is constant. Otherwise, the output voltage will never be constant, but the variation of the output voltage can be very small with respect to the variation of the input voltage. Now, let's do the same thing, do the same calculation. Assuming that the value of ZZ to be say 20 ohms. Now let's do the same thing. That means let us now add some non-ideality into the problem with incorporation of a Zener resistance. Now let's add some non-ideality. Let's assume that ZZ is equal to 20 ohms. That means the voltage across this one will never be constant. And let's assume that VZ is equal to, so now if you don't have a constant VZ. So last time we have seen that if ZZ is equal to 0 ohms, then VZ will be constant always, irrespective of the current, whether it is IZK or it is IZM, or whether the current is in between IZK or IZM. So that VZ will always be constant, that is 14 volt, because you have simply a battery like this, irrespective of the current flowing through the circuit. Assuming that the current is within this range of IZK to IZM, so that voltage is always VZ. But if ZZ is non-zero, like 20 ohms, then you need to specify the value of VZ at certain voltage. At certain voltage, let's consider this VZ is equal to 14 volt with a current of say 30 milliampere. So ZZ is equal to 20 ohm, that's fine. And you cannot mention the VZ in isolation when ZZ is non-zero. So that VZ is equal to 14 volt at IZ is equal to 30 milliampere. So within this IZK to IZM range. So now you have to find out what is the minimum value, the same question, what is the minimum input voltage required for the regulation. So now what you understand is, so now the Zener diode, which was previously modeled like a, it was modeled like a simple battery. So now apart from the battery, you do have a resistance as well. So that is the VZ naught, and now we have some ZZ. What is V out? Is output voltage. This output voltage is nothing but VZ naught plus the current flowing through the diode multiplied with ZZ. So it was 14 volt when IZ is equal to 30 milliampere. So obviously when IZ is 1 milliampere, 1.5 milliampere here, obviously this V out will be less than 14 volt. It's quite obvious. So that V out you can easily calculate from the expression we have already derived. It's nothing but this VZ minus delta IZ times ZZ. Now with VZ to be 14 volt, and then the delta IZ value will be 30 milliampere minus 1.5. So it's 30 minus 1.5. milliampere, so 10 to the power minus 3 into resistance is 20 ohms. So it's like 28.5.001 into 20 will give you 0.57. So 14 minus 0.57. That means it's like 13.43 volt. So now the voltage is not constant. So when the voltage is constant at 14 volt, when the current is 30 milliampere, I mean, VZ is equal to 14 volt when the current is 30 milliampere. Now, if the current is less than 30 milliampere, obviously the output voltage will be less than 14 volt, and it is coming like 13.43 volt. Now, under this condition, you can find out what is the value of Vin. So then this Vin minus Vout upon 560 ohms is equal to now the same IZK, the knee current. So V in minus V out is coming like, you have 560 into 1.5 into 0.01, it's coming like 0.84, same 0.84 volt. So now V in minimum is given by 13.43. Plus 0.84, that is 14.27 volt. 14.27 volt. So that is the Vin minimum value. Last time you have got like 14.84. Now this time it is 14.27 volt. Now let's do the same calculation for the minimum, for the maximum Zener currents. Now when the Zener current is maximum, then what about the input voltage? So now you can write V out as vz plus delta iz into zz. So that vz was 14 volt when the current was 30 milliampere, and I have assumed that the maximum zener current izm is equal to 70 milliampere, and test current iz is equal to 30 milliampere, at which you have vz is equal to 14 volt. So it will be 70 minus 30 into 10 to the power minus 3 into zz, you have like 20 ohms. So now 70 minus 30 will give you 40. 70 minus 30 will give you 40 into 20 into 10 to the power minus 1 will give you 0.8. So the variation, it will be 14.8 volt. Then what about the input voltage? So that input voltage should be the maximum input voltage that can be regulated, because now the current flowing through the circuit is maximum. So following the same analogy, V in minus V out by 560, that is equal to now IZM. And already we have calculated this one, 560 into 70 milliamperes will give you 39.2. So V in will be 14.8 plus 39.2. That is coming like 54 volt. So now we can understand what is the essence of adding a Zener diode in the circuit. What is the utility of having Zener diode in the circuit? Considering a practical Zener diode with a non-zero Zener resistance. So what you find is, with a practical one, the minimum input voltage was 14.27 volt. So let me summarize over here. So the minimum input voltage, V in minimum, was, with a practical Zener diode, was 14.27 volt. And the maximum input voltage that can be regulated by the Zener diode is given by 54 volt. Whereas the minimum output voltage when the current through the Zener diode is the minimum, the minimum output voltage we have calculated that current with that voltage with a knee current of 1.5 milliampere, that kind was 13.43 volt. So that kind was 13.43 volt, that voltage, 13.43 volt with Zener current to be 1.5 milliampere, 13.43 volt. And the maximum output voltage already have calculated to be 14.8 volt. So now side by side, I have written all the data. So now you can side by side, you can compare. So what is the utility of having a Zener diode in the circuit? Whereas the input voltage varies from 14 or 15 volt, 14.27, so it's close to 14.5 or so, 14.27 volt to 54 volt, the output variation is only from 13.43 to 14.8 volt. So you can regulate the corresponding variation in input voltage by means of a Zener circuit, by means of a Zener diode. And very easily you can identify what is the value of delta V in. So what is delta V in? That is very much 54 minus 14.27. That is coming like 39.73 volt. And what about delta V out? That is pretty small. Only 1 volt, so 14.8 minus 13.43, that is coming like 1.37 volt only. So now you understand what is the percentage. So now I'm talking about the percentage line regulation. So percentage line regulation, we would like to minimize this percentage line regulation. So even if there is a change in the line voltage, the output voltage doesn't get affected. So it's nothing but delta V out upon delta V in 100%. So if you put the value here, you find 1.37 divided by 39.73 into 100 will give you 3.45% only. 3.45%. That means if the input voltage changes by 100%, then the corresponding variation in the output voltage is only 3.45. So that variation can be regulated by means of a Zener diode connected in that fashion. So these are the two basic objective of having a Zener diode in any electronic circuit. First one is to suppress any variation in the input voltage so that that variation cannot be reflected output side. So even if there is certain variation in the input voltage, like this problem, the output voltage is remaining almost constant as long as the Zener diode is in the breakdown region. That is the first objective. And the second one is that even if the input voltage is constant and even if the load resistance changes, because as you know, even the input voltage constant, but the load resistance changes, it's a variable load resistance, then obviously the amount of load current will be different and accordingly the output voltage gets fluctuated. So even if the load voltage is not constant, load resistance is not constant, there is a change in the load resistance. But if you connect a Zener diode in parallel, in shunt with this load resistance, then as long as the Zener diode is in the breakdown region, then this fluctuation in the load resistance can be arrested to some extent. So these are the two different attributes of a Zener diode. And accordingly, to identify or to calculate the efficacy with which the Zener diode is operating in the circuit, two different percentage, two different parameters are specified. One is known as the line regulation, when the input voltage gets modified, and you have to identify what is the change in the corresponding output voltage. So that corresponding parameter, performance parameter, is known as the line regulation, which is given by this particular expression, delta V out upon delta V. And the second one was the load regulation, a percentage load regulation, which is given by the variation in the no load voltage with respect to the full load voltage, that is VNL minus VFL by VFL. Now, ideally, that variation should be zero, but practically, some variation will be there. But the objective here is to minimize that fluctuation to some extent. And if the value of the Zener resistance is very small, then you can expect that that variation can be neglected, can be reduced to some extent. Now, with this, I would like to conclude this tutorial class on the Zener diode set.